Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name's Susan Marks. I'm from the Law Department here at LSE, and it's my very great pleasure to welcome you on this evening of seriously inclement weather. You've made the right decision, though, I can assure you, because tonight's speaker is somebody really very special, someone at the epicenter of debates about one of the most serious problems we face in the world today, the persistence, and in some places spread and intensification of hunger and malnutrition. Olivier De Schutter is professor at the Center for Philosophy of Law and the Institute for Interdisciplinary Research in Legal Sciences at the University of Louvain in Belgium. He's a member of the UN Committee on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, the body that oversees the implementation of the Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights. And between 2008 and 2014, he served as UN Special Rapporteur on the right to adequate food, a role in which he made, I think it's universally believed, a truly outstanding contribution, not only to the promotion of the right to adequate food, but also to our understanding of the scope and implications of that right in the context of changing food systems and more generally globalization. He's chair of the International Panel of Experts on Sustainable Development and of the Belgian Advisory Council on Policy Coherence in Development. And he's founder and coordinator of the EU Network of Independent Experts on Fundamental Rights. He served for many years as well as General Secretary of the Paris-based International Federation for Human Rights, better known as the FIDH, where he focused on issues around the intersection of globalization and human rights. In between all of that, he somehow found time to produce a huge body of academic writing, both in French and English, as well as very, very many exceptionally influential reports for the UN and other international agencies, as well as regional agencies, national bodies, and non-governmental bodies. He's also written a large number of media pieces. He's a public intellectual in the very best, most serious sense. Tonight, Professor De Schutter will speak to us about what he terms the coming food revolution. How are we to deal with a situation in which undernutrition coexists with obesity, and in which the destruction of peasantries goes hand in hand with frightening levels of ecological destruction? Are technical fixes enough, or do we need to think more ambitiously about ways out of this perilous predicament in which we find ourselves? And what role can be played in these discussions of the human right to adequate food? Well, let's hear what Professor De Schutter has to say, but just before we do, I need to mention that this event is being video recorded. Professor De Schutter will speak for some period of time, possibly up to an hour, and then we'll have at least half an hour for discussion. So thank you for being with us, and welcome, Professor De Schutter.
Thank you very much. I shall try to use this microphone in the hope that this works, and if it doesn't, please do alert me to that.
I'll turn this off, maybe.
Perhaps. And thank you very much for this extremely kind and extensive, unnecessarily long introduction, Susan. Let me perhaps start by showing a picture of two important figures in this debate. And let me just try to understand whom the audience is made of. Who recognizes one of these figures? Any idea? Many of you weren't born back then. So, on the upper left hand of the slide is Earl Butz, who was the Secretary of Agriculture of President Nixon in the early 1970s. And on the right-hand side, on the lower part of the slide, is Sikiman Holt, who was the first commissioner for agriculture within the European Commission, a Dutch commissioner. He later became the president of the European Commission, and he launched in 1958, 1960, the Common Agricultural Policy. And these are two figures who are well known to have promoted a model of agricultural production that is called productionist or productivist. The idea being that they encouraged farmers to grow as large volumes as possible in the belief, the sincere belief and the understandable belief that that was the solution to global hunger, to produce more, to promote more efficient modes of production on a large scale by promoting industrial types of farming. And the results of these policies are shown in part on this graph that describes the evolution of the prices of food commodities on global markets since the 1960s. And as you can see, until recently, we witnessed a gradual decline in general of the prices of food, with some spikes, however, some peaks, particularly in 1973, 1974, as a result of the oil crisis and as a result of very poor harvests in Ukraine, which was then part of the USSR. And more recently, this has changed, of course, with the global food price crisis in 2008, which again was replicated in 2010. The decline of these prices was the result of an overproduction on global markets that led to a lowering of prices on international markets. And the approach that people like Earl Butz and Siki Mansholt had was perfectly understandable in the context in which they were making decisions. This is another graph that shows this context, and it is a graph showing how demographic growth globally has evolved over the years. As you can see, when these decisions were made, when the Common Agricultural Policy was shaped, when Earl Butz was Secretary of Agriculture of President Nixon in the early 1970s, demographic growth was at its peak. It was about 2.3, 2.4% per year on a global basis, with a very important growth, particularly in South Asia and some part of Africa. Demographic growth, of course, is a result both of fertility rates and of increased life expectancy. And when medicine makes progress and when countries develop, life expectancy rises and fertility rates remain high until women receive better education and until social protection makes progress. So in the 1960s, we were at a peak. And if you're surprised by this sudden dip in demographic growth that you see in the late 1950s, the early 1960s, well, this is the result of the foolish policies pursued by Mao Zedong in China. 35 million people died in 3 years as a result of the Great Leap Forward, misnomer, I suppose, as a result of famines in China that the Chinese government did not react to as it should have. Anyway, that is the context. And in that context, of course, many economists and policymakers took the view that famines would be recurring unless we invested lots of effort into boosting agricultural production. And one of these doomsday professionals was Professor Paul Ehrlich, an economist in the US, who published in 1968 this best-selling book, The Population Bomb, calling to increase production because there was an urgent need to match demographic growth. And he warned us in terms that are remindful of Thomas Malthus's work in the late 1700s, that unless we invested much more in increasing production, we would face recurring famines as a result of scarcity. And so the result of these policies of the 60s and 70s are shown on this graph. As you can see, all the world population continued to increase during those 40, 50 years after the early 1960s, and that is shown by the dotted line in gray here, the second line from above on the graph. Agricultural production globally was growing even faster than population itself. And those 50, 60 years between 1960 roughly and today were years in which gradually there was more and more overproduction. Supply not only matched demand, but actually increased much faster than population growth itself. Now, some 60 years after these choices were made that have shaped our food systems, we realize, however, that the approach adopted in the past was misguided for a number of reasons that we had failed to anticipate. And we actually have developed what I would call a low-cost food economy, in which all decisions were made with a view to increasing production and with a view to providing cheap calories or dumping cheap calories on the market, which even low-income households would be able to afford, but that was done at a very high cost. What was done was to prioritize a type of farming that was based on a low remuneration for food producers, low wages for workers in the food system, compensated, however, by subsidies going to agricultural producers, and the common agricultural policy or the successive farm bills adopted in the US are a testimony of that important tool. This low-cost food economy prioritized large-scale farming, the development of large monocultures on which tractors could operate, and although they used lots of energy, they were efficient in increasing overall production. Indeed, access to energy, to fossil fuels, was subsidized, and the costs imposed on the collectivity, environmental, social, health costs, were not internalized in the price of food, an issue I shall return to. This low-cost food economy, however, produced major negative impacts, what economists call negative externalities, that I'd like to summarize by referring respectively to the environmental impacts, the social impacts, and the public health impacts. Environmental impacts, first of all. Look at the situation in the UK. In the UK, agriculture accounts for less than 1% of the workforce, about 0.6% of the GDP of the country, and that is shown by the first two lines on this table provided by the Department of Environment, Food and Rural Affairs in the UK. But agricultural production is responsible for a significant part of greenhouse gas emissions, about 12-13%. And most of these emissions are the result of nitrous oxide emissions coming from the use of chemical fertilizers, and of methane emissions from industrial livestock production and from a poor management of landfills, essentially, right? Agricultural waste in particular. So agriculture, although employing less than 1% of the population in the UK, although representing less than 0.6% of the GDP, accounts for a significant proportion of the greenhouse gas emissions from the UK. And that is only agriculture. It does not take into account the processing of raw agricultural commodities. It does not take into account packaging, transport, the preservation of foods across the food chain. If you bring all this together, we find that the food system as a whole accounts for about 1/3 of total greenhouse gas emissions in a country such as the UK. Of course, policymakers have gradually become aware of these impacts, and there have been attempts to lower the use of chemical fertilizers in the fields, resulting in a some progress being made in the use of nitrogen-based fertilizers and thus the emissions of nitrous oxide, as shown on this graph that goes from 1990 to 2015, or this graph shows how methane emissions have been gradually reduced, but they remain quite significant, as shown on the graph earlier. Probably the most worrying impact of industrial farming has to do with soil health. I don't really have time to go into the details, but soil is degraded very heavily in many European countries, including in the UK. And the recent parliamentary group, the all-party parliamentary group on agroecology, has estimated that the impacts of soil erosion, of the loss of organic matter in the soil, soil compaction, degradation of soils in general, cost £1.2 billion to the British economy each year. So that's a very significant sum, only a small part of which, about one-fifth, is borne by the farmer. The rest is just a cost imposed on the collectivity that is not accounted for in the price of production. So soil erosion is one problem. It's the result of large monocultures developing so that wind and water wipes out, wipes away the topsoil in large proportions. The decline of organic matter in the soil means that soils are less well equipped to function as carbon sinks. Instead, they are net emitters of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Soil compaction is a result of soil being compacted because of heavy mechanization in industrial farming, and that makes the soil much less well equipped to capture moisture and to function as a sponge if you wish to avoid flood risks materializing. Soil can be contaminated as a result of pollution and the use of chemicals. That is also a serious problem in the UK as elsewhere. And finally, soil is being lost to development projects and to the building of highways and so on. This is called the sealing of the soil, which as a result of the artificialization of the soil is less able to fulfill its functions in the ecosystems. So soil health is a major issue and a very high price we pay for the industrialization of farming. The second negative impact has to do with the growth of large farms, increasing agrarian concentration, and the disappearance of small and less competitive farms from the agricultural landscape. And in fact, in this regard, the UK has gone further than any other state in the EU, except for one, the Czech Republic, which has, on average, larger farms even by the UK, but the UK ranks second out of the EU 28 member states. The average size of the farm in the UK, some of you may be surprised by this figure, is 84 hectares, which is huge. And as you can see from this graph, which comes from Eurostat data, 21% of the farms that have a very large size of more than 100 hectares use 72% of the land, the agricultural land used in this country. And if you combine those farms, those huge farms, with very large farms between 50 and 100 hectares, these 39% of the farms, they monopolize some 87% of the land available. And then you have mid-size or small farms that occupy much less of the available land in the UK, and a huge gap exists between these different worlds of farming that practice actually very different types of farming. And the problem is that even though farms have grown in size, have been able to achieve economies of scale, have been able to replace men and women with machines by developing on a very large scale, still almost half the farms in the UK in 2014 were working almost at a loss. These are data from, again, the Department of Environment, Food and Rural Affairs, who concluded that in 2014, 46% of the farms could not even recoup their costs. So they were working at a loss, and the pressure is on farms to expand, to get bigger, to eat up the land of the neighbor, or to disappear in the face of the competition that they face. The UK is not alone in this regard. In my own country, Belgium, we also see many small farms disappear every year, but the UK has gone further than any other state in Europe in this industrialization of farming. And then there are thirdly public health impacts of these choices that were made some 60 years ago. We have seen in the 1990s in particular, and now we've reached maybe a plateau in the UK, we've seen a very strong rise of overweight and obesity in the UK population. Look at these figures and compare 1993 with 10 years later, 2003. During this decade, the average obesity in the UK rose from 13-14%, there are slight differences between women and men, to more than 20%. And today, the average is 22%. 22% of working age population in the UK is obese, with a bodily mass index above 30. That is the standard measure of obesity. This is not yet having a major impact on the costs of public healthcare, but it shall have such an impact in future years, because of course, between the moment when a population develops obesity as, an epidemic, really, and the moment when diabetes, cardiovascular diseases, or colorectal cancers develop as a result of obesity, you need some 20, 25 years, right? So the worst is still to come with regard to the impacts on the healthcare system of this impressive growth of rates of obesity. Now, it's often thought that obesity primarily affects the working class, the lowest segment of the population, and based on some data I used, I was under this impression myself. In fact, what we learn from recent studies is that it's not that clear. Gender and social norms play a major role. Explaining that in the UK, for example, these are data from the UK, the least affected by obesity are the very poor men and the richest women. Poor men, probably because they expend lots of energy performing demanding physical labor, despite bad eating habits in many cases, and rich women because they are very sensitized to their image, because they care about what they eat and have all the information required to eat healthily and to have diverse diets. But obesity is a risk for middle-class men, for poor women. That is the highest rate of obesity we have. Poor women have an obesity rate in this country that is about 28%. Much of this obesity can be attributed to the food environment, how it's been shaped by the kind of food that is put on the table and that is sold on supermarkets. And to cut a long story short, what we've seen is a greater dependency on processed or ultra-processed foods, snacks, ready-to-eat meals that you simply can microwave and you don't have to really cook at home. And it is this that was favored by agricultural policies that prioritized the production of large cereals, raw commodities really for the food processing industry, and did not prioritize the production of food that people actually could eat without going through a processing by large companies. So it is the rise in the consumption of processed foods associated with lifestyle changes that is the real explanation for these increased rates of obesity. And then finally, I must add that one fourth important impact of this productionist paradigm was on developing countries. And if you want one slide that summarizes the question of hunger, I would propose that this may be one candidate, showing how our choices to overproduce agricultural commodities in our countries has had an impact on developing countries' ability and willingness to invest in their own domestic food production. What has happened in many low-income countries, right, the 48 poorest countries on Earth, what has happened is that these countries have witnessed increased agrarian concentration, in other terms, large landowners developing alongside small farmers who remain the majority in agriculture in these countries. This competition for resources, for access to political influence, for access to credit, for access to infrastructure, this competition worked against the interests of small-scale farmers. Many small farmers had to abandon agriculture that was not viable anymore for them to make a decent livelihood. They migrated to cities. Urban public services were completely overwhelmed by this rural to urban migration that all developing countries witnessed over the past 30 years. Slums developed. And what could governments do in these countries but import more from international markets, cheap food, subsidized by OECD taxpayers? So we overproduced, we dumped cheap calories on the local markets of developing countries' economies. These countries' governments were not incentivized to invest in their own domestic production. How could you possibly compete with the US Treasury or with the Common Agricultural Policy anyway? And as a result, small farmers were forced into subsistence farming, or they were forced to abandon agriculture altogether and to migrate to cities. And the result is even more agrarian concentration, even more dependency on imports for these poor countries, and a lack of investment in production of food to satisfy their own needs. It's very sad, this story of countries who, although they are still agriculture-based, although they still have, in many cases, the majority of the population working in agriculture, have become dependent on imports to feed themselves, and therefore, when the prices skyrocket on international markets, are caught in a trap and suddenly discover that they cannot pay their food bills. And this is exactly what happened in 2008. So, a sustainable food system is the opposite of this, right? It's a system that would prioritize diets that are culturally adapted rather than artificially manufactured by the food industry. It's a food system that would provide for decent livelihoods for all workers in the food industry and for farmers. It's a food system that would be attentive to the ecological footprint of how we produce and consume food. It's a food system that would provide a diversity of foods that people may choose from and that would maintain them in good health rather than make them sick. It's a food system that would prioritize rural development and local economies' ability to prosper. And this is not at the expense of other sectors. In fact, in many developing countries, if rural poverty were to be effectively reduced, this would mean huge market opportunities for the industry and for the services sectors who would benefit from that reduction in poverty. That's a simple Keynesian argument that I could develop, but I don't have time to do so now. And finally, it is a food system that would limit the impact, the disruptive impacts on other food systems, as we've done by dumping food on developing countries' markets. The problem is that although there's a relative consensus on this, since now perhaps 9 or 10 years, certainly since this global food crisis of 2008, nothing changes. And nothing changes because the system is one in which the different components have co-evolved and have become mutually supportive. And the system can be described relatively economically by this slide, illustrating how social technical choices, social economic choices, social cultural trends, and social political situations have been supporting each other and mutually reinforcing each other. Very briefly, we've invested in research and development, in infrastructures, in technologies that have prioritized large-scale industrial farming. In many cases, the infrastructures were built by the big companies themselves, and it is these companies who've been influencing states as to in which technologies to invest and in which research and development to perform. In fact, much research and development is now performed by the companies themselves, serving their needs and their kind of production. As a result, the economic dominance of the big corporate actors in the food system has been reinforced over the years. Concentration has increased. These actors achieve economies of scale. They're highly efficient. They control the logistics. They have access to infrastructure. In other terms, they're far more competitive than small farmers who are not in a position to compete, especially given that many of the subsidies go to these larger actors of the food system. These actors pretend that they respond to the demands of the population, to the tastes of the population, as these tastes have developed. And yes, it is true that our ways of eating, our eating habits, have been shaped by the industrial food system. And these eating habits correspond to lifestyles that are hurried, that include, you know, long commuting time from home to work, that must take into account the fact that families are smaller than in the past, and very often we have single-parent families, so there are fewer incentives to cook at home. That is one reason why convenience foods are so popular in our advanced societies. And to illustrate, this is one picture showing what this average British family consumes per week. This picture is actually from a photographer who traveled across all continents and asked the families he met to show what they consume during the week. It's very interesting to see how Italy, France, the UK, the US illustrate these trends in diet. But as you can see, much of this food is processed, much is packaged, of course. It took huge amounts of energy, not just to produce the food, but more importantly, to package it, to process it, to preserve it, and to stock it between when it was produced and when it was consumed. And this family has much less reliance on fresh foods cooked at home than on processed foods that are microwaved or even consumed without any operation whatsoever. So lifestyles have evolved in support of the system. And finally, politicians are not under a very strong incentive to change things. Not only because of the influence that big actors have in politics, but especially because policymakers measure the effectiveness or the efficiency of different ways of farming by using measures that are very misleading. For example, they use cost-benefit analysis to favor industrial farming, forgetting that cost-benefit analysis that discounts negative externalities is deeply biased. And, as I tried to illustrate, industrial farming has huge, unaccounted for negative externalities, whilst small-scale, agroecological types of farming has positive externalities to provide that it is not rewarded for. Politicians also are not willing to say to the public that the low-cost food economy is not a viable one, that perhaps the price of food should increase rather than decrease regularly. Today, the average family in the UK spends 12% of its income on buying food. It was 40% in 1945. Which politician would dare say that the real price of food is really double than what people pay at when checking out from supermarkets. But in fact, what the consumer does not pay for the food because of the unaccounted for externalities is paid for by the taxpayer, having to pay for healthcare, having to pay for wiping out the environmental damage, having to pay the subsidies that go to the farmers. So it's a very problematic calculation, and this focus on low price of food is really a pretext to not implement much more robust social policies that should allow all families, even poor families, to afford a decent diet. And I am personally convinced that cheap calories, poor quality foods, affordable even for the poor, are not a substitute for more robust social policies that should allow everyone to eat healthily. Anyway, these are the lock-ins, the blockages in the system that explain the resilience of the system, its inertia, the difficulty we have changing it. The UK, like other countries, but this illustrates this question for the UK, is a system or an agricultural has an agricultural policy that has developed a very important dependence on imports. Paradoxically, for certain ranges of food. In fact, as a result of globalization, favored by trade liberalization, countries, regions have specialized into a relatively narrow range of commodities. So rather than pursuing diversity and the production of a wide range of crops, each country, each region has been specializing into what it is best at, according to the law of comparative advantage, that is, of course, that on which international trade is based. And the choice of the UK was to produce cereals, but to import most of its fruits, most of its vegetables. On average, the UK actually exports about 10% of what it produces, and it supplies the local markets with the rest of what it produces, but it imports much more than it exports. And for fresh vegetables, this is imports from the UK and exports from the UK. And the same is valid for fresh fruits. Many more imports, the dark green line, and very few exports from the UK of fresh fruits. Even in wheat, the UK has become dependent over the years. It was a net exporter until 2011, and now it has become a net importer. Now, why has the UK specialized into cereals and neglected producing fruits and vegetables? For a very simple reason. Labor-intensive production is not viable in an economy that seeks to provide high wages. And the only way some still produce fruit and vegetable in the UK is by hiring people coming from Eastern Europe at, you know, very low wages, often migrant workers who spend just one season in the UK before returning home. So agriculture in the UK, like in other countries, has been increasing output per worker. The productivity per labor has increased significantly over the past 30 or 40 years, whereas productivity of land has remained essentially unchanged. And this is a graph showing that production per hectare of land has basically not moved over the past 40 years, or has increased in much lower proportions than productivity per active labor. So if this is the situation, what can the right to food contribute? Well, the right to food, as you know, has a very interesting history. It's been present in international law since the Universal Declaration of Human Rights of 1948, Article 25. It was, of course, referred to in the International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights that Susan Marx referred to, adopted in 1966. But it was not understood until 20 years ago. it was perceived as vague, as purely programmatic, as not providing a guide that governments could actually rely on, until the late 1980s, when it was found that we were failing to combat hunger effectively. And we were failing to combat hunger, remember, despite agricultural production increasing in comparison to demographic growth. So we were producing more and more. The technical recipes we were using were working. But hunger, and I could have added malnutrition, were persisting. Why? Well, because maybe we were not paying enough attention to the question of distributive justice, to the question of who produced, at which conditions, with which impacts on rural poverty and the spread of inequalities. And of course, much of the credit should go to Amartya Sen for having highlighted this feature of the food systems in a very important book published in 1981, Poverty and Famines, an Essay on Entitlement and Deprivation, the first two sentences of which are, the reason why people go hungry may be that there is not enough food, but there being not enough food is not the reason why people go hungry. And he meant by this that a lack of food may be one explanation, but in most cases is not the single explanation for famine. And indeed, he documented in his work that famines in the 20th century, beginning with the West Bengal famine of 1943-1944 that he witnessed as a child, 4.3 million people died in this famine. These famines occurred in times of plenty when the harvests were actually quite good. And so 1981, when he published this book, he actually alerted us to the fact that famines, hunger, were not a technical issue to be left to agronomists or even to economists. It was a deeply political issue that needed to be addressed with tools from human rights, from political science perhaps, and that it was a question of holding governments accountable to their populations. And in the 1990s, this message gradually penetrated the awareness of policymakers, so that in 1996, when they convened in Rome for the World Food Summit that was held then, they committed to, and this is almost a literal quote from the action plan they adopted, to clarify the content of the right to adequate food and to give particular attention to implementation of that right. And in response to this call, the Committee on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights adopted in 1999 its general comment number 12, clarifying the normative content of the right to food. And when the World Food Summit was reconvened 5 years later, it was meant to be November 2001, but because of the 9/11 events, it was postponed to the year thereafter, so it was still called 5 years later, the World Food Summit 5 years later, held 6 years after the first one, that decided to launch negotiations on this important document, these voluntary guidelines in support of the progressive realization of the right to adequate food in the context of national food security, that provides a very extensive list of commitments governments agreed to implement the right to food. So the right to food really was born at the time, right? The late 1990s, the early years of the past decade, less than 20 years ago, was the birth date of the right to food, which is now present in international conferences in ways it never was in the 1970s or 1980s. And I believe this can help, but to understand why, we need to understand a bit more why food systems are so difficult to reform. And I'd like to take as departure point what is known as the multi-level perspective on transition. This is a view that was developed by especially Dutch scholars, although they happen to be working for many of them in the UK, that initially was developed to understand how technological changes occurred and were basically co-opted by the industry. And what they tried to highlight is that transition, but they studied technological transitions in particular, could be understood by looking at three levels. The landscape level, these are exogenous factors such as changes in consumer tastes, globalization, concerns for sustainability, or indeed the pressures from the environment, right? Biophysical realities that impose changes in the system. So these are landscape developments. In the middle is the socio-technical regime. What are the components, rather, of the mainstream regime that is dominant in a particular time, in a particular sector? And then some niche innovations, as they call them, right? Niche innovations by some researchers, by some social activists that at a very large scale develop new tools, new ways of doing things, or new technologies indeed, that can provide a solution if the system falls apart, undergoes a crisis, is pressured by landscape developments, etc. And that is the view of transition that they defend. Now, it seems to me that this multi-level perspective on transition is very useful to understand what is happening today to create the food revolution. What are we seeing? We are seeing a mainstream system that I described as very inert, very resistant to change because it's composed of different elements that are mutually supportive, that are cementing the system and that have co-evolved over the years, right? So how can this dominant regime be displaced despite all the, you know, economic, cultural, technological, and political factors that seem to reinforce it year after year? Well, maybe by betting on these niche innovations that some social activists, farmers, NGOs are developing. And as in other countries, in the UK, we see this happening. We see short food chains develop. We see fair trade schemes become more and more popular for tropical products. We see people buying, taking into account social and environmental considerations, right? So sending a political message with their purchasing practices. We see, as we see in Bristol, for example, food policy councils being established, developing food plans, action plans, as they did in Bristol, as they did in Cork, as they did in some other places, to reshape the food systems starting from the urban areas at city level with the support of the municipality. The Bristol Good Food Plan is one good example in which citizens demanded that the city of Bristol create a new food system for the city. They established a food policy council for that purpose that adopted a Bristol Good Food Plan that seeks to reconcile people with their food, challenge food poverty in poor neighborhoods in Bristol, and there are quite a few there, create a food culture that would promote healthy foods that are locally sourced from small farmers producing sustainable type of farming, and through a range of policies, that kind of link between producers and consumers has been encouraged. This is not proper to the UK. It's something that has been developing all over the world, and in fact, in October 2015, in this beautiful palace of Milan, the Milan Urban Food Policy Pact was adopted. Today, it brings together more than 130 cities across the world. And in this pact, mayors from across the world pledge to take a number of actions to build local sustainable food systems, primarily by linking urban consumers to the food producers of the hinterland, by using, for example, public procurement schemes, by encouraging school canteens to source food locally and to provide healthy diets to children who then can import their knowledge into their families by creating or supporting urban and peri-urban agriculture and vegetable gardens managed by neighborhood communities and so on. So a range of commitments that include a commitment to have much more inclusive forms of governance at local level. And this is one short excerpt of the framework for action that was adopted in Milan. Now, I'm not romanticizing local action, and I should warn against two dangers that have been highlighted in transition theory, researchers working on transition theory. One is that we may, in our haste to promote localism and the revival of local agri-food systems as a reaction to globalization, a counter-movement, as Carl Poliani would say, we may forget that that may trigger xenophobic sentiments, nativist sentiments, us against them, if you wish. It may underplay power relationships in local settings. And yes, in a country such as UK, that having voted to leave the EU may have encouraged a resurgence of these xenophobic sentiments, it's important to be attentive to this critique. Secondly, there's another critique, which is that asking communities to do more at the local level to rebuild local agri-food systems, bringing together urban consumers and local food producers, is actually providing a convenient pretext for the state to disregard its own duties to support the poor constituents and to improve the healthiness of food systems. We all remember that David Cameron was promoting this idea of the big society, by which he meant that communities should take care of themselves and that neighbors should support each other. And the underlying message was the welfare state is passé, and we may count on local support groups to take over whatever tasks the welfare state cannot afford anymore to provide. And we should be aware that this is a real danger. In fact, Nate McClintock published this article. I like the title very much, Radical Reformist and Garden Variety Neoliberal on Urban Agriculture, in which he showed that although urban agriculture could be very positive in building community links, in allowing neighbors to reclaim the commons, in allowing local communities to control means of production of their food. So there are many positive dimensions to urban agriculture. There are also serious problems in serving the shadow state, that is, the neoliberal view that communities take over from the welfare state that is delinquent in relinquishing its duties. And this discourse about urban agriculture may be promoting a mentality of self-help, of local entrepreneurship that indeed fits into the neoliberal schema. So these dangers are real. But the answer is not to dismiss these social innovations, these grassroots niches that are developing, but rather to strengthen them by promoting food democracy. And I believe there's a mutually supportive relationship between grassroots social innovations that I described, right? Short food chains, farmer to consumer direct relationships, city food action plans, and so on, and food democracy, by which I mean something very precise that is developing in the UK as elsewhere, by which I mean different stakeholders of the food system coming together in a food policy council, addressing recommendations to policymakers, to municipal councils, for example, in order to put pressure on politicians to deliver for healthier and more sustainable food systems. Food democracy can ensure that these social innovations will be socially inclusive, that they will neglect no important interests, that they will not serve as a pretext for the state to forget about its duties because of communities taking their fate in their own hands, etc. And conversely, these social innovations can empower democracy by broadening political imagination, by showing politicians that there are alternatives they could support to, you know, big food and large-scale industrial food production, that there are, that there's a demand within the public for something else, and that people, if well educated as to the impacts of the food systems that we've inherited, could make different choices, and that actually politicians have an important role to play in allowing this transition to take place. So that would be my first sort of suggestion as to what the right to food can provide. The right to food is inter alia about food democracy, about participation in shaping the choices that make up our food system. Secondly, food democracy is a way to simply recapture political decision making from the influence under which it is. And at the risk of repeating myself, I'm sorry, Susan, because I evoked this study in our lunch meeting, which I enjoyed very much, by the way. I mentioned or alluded to this study by Martin Gillins and Benjamin Page, published a couple of years ago, based on a study of US politics. It's very depressing. You know, Thursday night, first week after the break, it's raining outside, and I'm dumping on you a very depressing message about politics. They studied 1,779 policy issues that were presented for decision to the US Congress. And for each of these issues, they asked, what were the positions of big corporations, as expressed by the International Chamber of Commerce and so on, and what were the positions of the public, as shown in opinion polls? Average citizens' preferences played basically no role in shaping decisions by the US Congress, right? So for example, here you have between 80 and 90% of the population favoring a particular outcome. Here you have between 90 and 100% of the public favoring a particular outcome. A small number of policy decisions fall in this category, but still, it's something. Well, despite an overwhelming support of the public for these decisions, the likelihood of these decisions being taken important than if you have, you know, less than 10% of the population supporting the decision, right? The columns are the number of policy decisions, but what's important, of course, is the relationship between the percentage of the population supporting an outcome and what the likelihood of that outcome being chosen is, right? Now, corporations can essentially veto decisions if there's, you know, only 20% of the corporations in support of a particular measure, the likelihood of the measure being adopted is very small indeed. Instead, if you have more than 80% or 90% of corporations in favor of a decision, the likelihood is very high that it shall be adopted. So the message is democracy needs to be reignited. It is not working as it should today. And of course, I believe that the US is in a particularly bad position given the role of money in politics. The best democracy money can buy is the joke that they use in the US. But I think that this is very much something we also should be paying attention to at this side of the Atlantic. One consequence of decisions concerning food policies not being democratically adopted, not being transparent enough, not being participatory enough, is that in this struggle between the economic logic and other logics, the economic logic trumps the others. Let me explain this. My friend Jan Douwe van der Ploeg is now retiring from his chair at Wageningen University, and he was one of the most brilliant agronomists of his generation. He wrote a lot on peasantry. And he presents this slide, or this, actually this is a scheme in a book of his, showing the contradiction between the two logics. Right? So it's very simple, although it looks complicated. I don't have something to point, no, well, never mind. So if you look at the above part of the slide, yes, but I'm short. The above part of the slide, farmers in the industrial way of farming, they have to use inputs that they buy on markets, right? Chemical fertilizers, seeds, pesticides. They inject this in production and then they produce an output for the market. Why must they sell for the market? Well, because they have to make money from their production in order to buy their seeds, their pesticides, and their chemical fertilizers, okay? So basically, they will make their choices to have a marketable output based on the prices the crops can fetch on the market. So they will produce maize one year, soybean the other year, depending on how prices evolve on the market, okay? Because they have high production costs. That logic of how decisions are made is in complete contradiction with the ecological logic that would dictate making choices based on soil health, based on which crops are best combined with one another, based on how trees, plants, and animals can complement each other on the farm. And that's the agroecological logic. It's a very different logic, which is illustrated by the bottom side of this slide. Agricultural production is to a certain extent going to the market and to own consumption. But some of it is also regenerating resources, feeding into production in a cyclical approach that is typical of agroecology, right? Well, never mind, I don't have really time to discuss agroecology, although this is a great of great interest to me, but the bottom line is, if choices as to what to produce, when to produce, are dictated by the market and the prices as they evolve on the market, they will not correspond to the common sense that ecological equilibria require or that the ecosystems require to be maintained. And so, to me, one of the major stakes of democracy in food systems is to ensure that the economic logic does not trump all other logics that are based on well-being, on health, and on sustainability. Thirdly and finally, the right to food, as you'll see if you read general comment number 12 of the Committee on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, is about a new way of governing food systems that is much more multi-year, taking the long-term view of things, that is much more participatory, involving stakeholders in shaping decisions, as I mentioned when I referred to food policy councils, and that is much more multi-sectoral, not seeing agriculture separately from the environment, from the health, from development, cooperation, and so forth. Yet, we've been segmenting policies, we've been developing policies in a way that is not participatory, and we've been developing policies that are driven by short-term concerns, at most the next election, and as a result, we've developed food systems that are not sustainable. If you read the general comment number 12 of the Committee on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, and we said the same for other rights than the right to food, we recommend right to food policies being adopted. What are right to food policies? Well, very simply, they are action plans that are multi-year plans, for 5, 7, 10 years, perhaps, defining very precisely what are the needs, what are the issues to be addressed, what measures should be taken, within which time frame, by which branch of government or which actor within the governmental apparatus. And adopting such an action plan allows the media, the opposition political parties, the civil society organizations to hold governments accountable for results. As long as you simply preach in the abstract for the right to food or for sustainable food systems, it's very difficult to to pinpoint at failures from the government. There will always be one more urgency to be attended, and there will always be one good reason to postpone action. But once you develop an action plan by involving civil society in identifying priorities, having a very clear timeline for actions to be taken, identifying whom is responsible for doing what, accountability in the realization of that important social right, the right to adequate food, will be significantly improved. And that is what these national action plans achieve. In addition, they allow for multi-sectoral approaches so that a food policy, in the example of the right to food, can be developed, and not simply an agricultural policy that promotes industrial farming, an environmental policy that tries to compensate for the negative impacts of the agricultural policy, a health policy that tries to heal those made sick by industrial ways of producing food and bad diets. Instead, a food policy would be bringing all this together in a coherent whole. And such a food policy could support these grassroots innovations, these local niche innovations, as they are called in transition theory, developed by citizens, by consumer groups, by civil society, or indeed by cities, by mayors, because these action plans could seek to support these innovations, to scale them up, to scale them out, to make them more widespread in the way they are adopted, in order to provide gradually alternatives to the mainstream food system. And I actually was at Oxford last week for the Oxford Real Farming Conference, as they call it, which also discussed, inter alia, a people's food policy for the UK. And I know that some activists in the next few months shall be trying to convince politicians in Westminster to espouse this cause for a people's food policy in the UK that would be developed with the strong participation of civil society, that would be a multi-year action plan to improve the food situation in the UK, so that we move from the situation we have now, very resistant to change, very part dependent, based on choices made 50 years ago that in a world very different than ours today, to something very different, and that I hope will allow to finally realize the right to food. Thank you.
Anyone else at this point? Perhaps this gentleman here. To address these.
Okay, thank you very much. We should have taken a poll, I guess, as to whom is more depressed or instead more energized by, I'm not sure what I was trying to achieve, but it's an interesting conclusion you draw, Susan, from what I said. L'optimisme de la volonté is what you should call it, I suppose. Meat and fish consumption. I agree with you that it's something it's a major part of the equation that I have omitted and perhaps wrongly so. Let me simply say this: meat consumption is much higher in rich countries than it's ought to be to be nutritionally adequate. We consume in the UK, you consume in the UK about 90 kilograms of meat per year per person, when actually it would be enough to consume about 30 kilograms. That's what nutritionists say. And as you know from the International Research Group on Cancer of the World Health Organization, it's now been shown that red meat consumption in particular, especially if it's processed meat, can have very serious negative impacts on health, including the development of certain types of cancers. But the major concern, and that's where your question comes from, is that meat produced by industrial livestock processors is using huge amounts of soybean, maize as feed, and that in turn uses large areas of land in particularly Brazil, Argentina, some parts of the US, that could be used much more efficiently to meet, to satisfy human needs. So I think it's a very serious concern, very difficult to stop, because in all developing countries, as a middle class emerges, they start eating more meat and they move to cities, and that is the diet that they aspire to. And also there is a strong belief in many circles, including in our countries, that without meat, the diet is imbalanced, which is not entirely true, in the sense that there are some micronutrients in meat that you cannot find easily elsewhere, B12 vitamins and certain aminated acids. But on the whole, and you alluded to this, it's possible to replace meat by vegetable proteins without, certainly for adults, without any problems. And so we should. The problem is that we need to educate people into cooking vegetarian dishes, which is not easy to achieve. Although in this country you have the chance of being in close contact with the Indian cuisine tradition, which is a very good source of inspiration. But I can assure you, in France, Belgium, you are laughed at when you say, as I do, that you're vegetarian and that you prefer not. And it's not unusual for me to go at a restaurant and not to find any dish I can have, right? So it is going to take time. But I agree it's a problem, and I agree it's part of the solution to reduce our meat consumption, absolutely. I should nuance by saying, in France, for example, most animals are not fed on grain but on pastures, and pastures hold carbon and should not be put into cultivation without huge impacts on climate change. So it's, there are more or less viable ways of producing meat. Closing this parenthesis. Anyway. Secondly, information about food. Yes, I agree it's a problem. And look, what we've seen is that traditional food cultures have been displaced, forgotten. People now do not know, in many cases, how to cook. I work with very poor families in Belgium, and a movement called ATD Fourth World. I'm not sure they're well known in the UK. It's an anti-poverty group. And I'm scandalized, shocked by the kind of food portions they receive, right? They receive snacks, they receive chips, they receive soft drinks from charities. But when you propose to them to have kale, right, or, you know, carrots, A, they say our children will not eat that, and B, they do not know how to cook this, right? So the I think the lack of cooking skills, and in the case of poor, very poor families, even the lack of electricity, right, to cook, these are serious obstacles for people to change diets. But information is a problem, and it's true that as food cultures have been displaced, people have, they do not know anymore how to eat healthily, and the information they have does not allow them to make well-informed choices. Any attempt to inform them better have been met with the strong opposition of the large agri-food companies. For example, there was an attempt at European level, at the European Parliament, to have a green light scheme, right? You would have green, orange, or red dots, I suppose, put on the traffic lights, put on the foods, and that was essentially vetoed by these actors. And I have to say, for not entirely unjustified reasons, because you don't eat food separately, you eat meals, and some Parmesan cheese, for example, is great if it makes your delicious and healthy vegetarian dish, you know, more tasty. I'm all for it. But Parmesan cheese would have had a red light on it, right? Because it's highly caloric, it's you know, full of saturated fats and so on. So we have to, but actually, within the Lancet Commission on Obesity, which I'm a member of, we are trying to understand the respective merits of different ways of informing the consumer as to what needs to be done, because usually people are completely lost and they do not know. You have to be a very well-trained expert to know what to eat. It's really complicated. I agree entirely with you. Now, the third question, which is the most likely direction? And I agree with you that we have two trends that, two curves that show opposite directions. On one hand, we have more and more concentration, a bigger weight of the food industry and competitiveness on a world scale between farmers that reduces small farmers to oblivion. On the other hand, we have a concern expressed by many within civil society. We have very promising changes that are made. And there are also reasons to hope. I think there are essentially two scenarios. One is we continue in business as usual, and we will at some point face a major crisis. For example, a very high price of fertilizers as a result of, you know, increased volatility on the markets of fossil energies, or major droughts and floods that will create panic on the markets and create huge volatility for net food importing countries. And that kind of crisis will lead to reassess how food systems are shaped, but that will be too late. And I very much hope that we will not have to wait for such a major crisis to develop, and that we will have the wisdom to prepare ourselves and develop more resilient, more local, and more sustainable food systems. The major obstacle to this, it seems to me, is in how decisions are made, and that is the exact reason why I emphasized food democracy. I spoke about the coming food revolution, and I used this provocative title for a reason. It is actually an allusion to to Hannah Arendt's work on revolution. She published this book in 1961, fantastic book, where she said essentially the French Revolution, the paradigm of all revolutions, was not a real revolution. It was a coup d'etat. Why was it a coup d'etat? Because these revolutionaries just grabbed power from the absolute monarch and exercised power in exactly the same way as it had been exercised in the past, right? From the center to the periphery, from the top to down, by technocrats and the elite and the literate to the people. And she said, no, they did a 360 degrees turn, and they ended up with exactly the same grammar of power that the absolute sovereign had been using. And she said the real revolution would be a 180 degrees turn towards the people. And what you are seeing with these food policy councils, with these transition towns, with these community-supported agricultural schemes in which people are concerned about their diets and, you know, directly see, you know, visit their farmer and have these short circuits developing. What we are seeing is democracy in action, food democracy in action, people not waiting for politicians to come up with solutions, not voting every 4 or 5 years and then being unfree in the interim, as Edmund Burke was saying, rather people understanding that the single most obstacle to having power is not daring to exercise it. And that is, I think, what we need to do. And in food, in the food sector, more even so than in the energy sector or in the mobility sector, we have many things developing that are a source of empowerment and democracy. So that's my hopeful line, but nothing's written. And I'm a hoper in the second scenario, but a believer in the first, I'm sorry to say.
I think we perhaps should be using the roving mics, right? So I think Andrew perhaps might be next. But I think for the video recording, we need the roving mics. That's my concern.
Thank you very much for your wonderful talk. I had a question about the place of localism in your vision of food democracy. So clearly, there's a central place, I think, for localization of food production, or at least I think in your vision. You mentioned a few dangers. One you didn't mention, which others have, is that the instability in terms of sources of food when you limit the sources that you're drawing on.
Yeah.
And I wondered whether there was, and also when you talk about the need for proper distribution of food, I guess that cuts against, I think, a focus on localism, right? To the extent that the distribution needs to be global. I wondered whether there was a choice, or at least maybe a twofold focus that was needed in a vision of food democracy, one in which the scale of food production is tied to a local democracy, but another in which democracy is scaled up to the scale of agricultural production. In other words, the project in part is about scaling up democracy to the scale of a global agricultural production system.
Yeah,
great question. It was somebody else in at the back, please.
It was an excellent presentation, and I know it was very centric to the UK. But I wonder whether there could be lessons that could be learned from the developing countries. For example, Bhutan has not only developed the world's first happiness index, they've also decided that the entire country is going to have agriculture without any fertilizers.
And I think, great. Sorry, I'm going to move to somebody over here. Yes, in the front. If you wouldn't mind.
Did you finish your question?
I'm sorry, had you finished?
No, she hadn't.
I'm sorry.
Mistaken, I think this is exactly what Jamie Oliver in the celebrity culture that the UK is embedded in is trying to change through school meals.
Yep.
Right, sorry. I'm just conscious of the time as well.
I've actually been really inspired by your work. I'm doing a competition law PhD, and we recently presented a paper, 3 months ago, on the right to food and competition law, and I know you've written quite extensively. You're probably the first person to bring the two subjects together. But when we presented the paper at this conference in St. Petersburg, there was a great deal of resistance by the traditional competition lawyers, almost like a shutter down. But I know that that's not the case in right to health, for instance, and the competition law has been able to take right to health into account, but there seems to be a far greater resistance towards the right to food, even though they recognize that this is clearly an important right. They think it belongs to the realm of justice and fairness and not necessarily competition law. So I wondered if you had any ideas on that issue as well.
Three great questions there. Unfortunately, we're more or less out of time, so I'm going to have to ask you to offer some concluding reflections on those.
Okay. So let me then very briefly address these important questions. First, Andrew, you're absolutely right. And amongst the promising developments I see is not only this rejuvenation of local democracy because of a demand for more sustainable local food systems, but also a greater transparency in how decisions concerning the global community are made. And particularly since you're interested in global governance issues, the Committee on World Food Security that was reformed in 2009 as a result of the global food crisis is unique for those studying global governance. It's really a very interesting example to look at, in that it brings together not just governments, but also civil society, the private sector, international agencies, in a forum that is far more transparent in its functioning than the normal intergovernmental processes that you are accustomed to in other fora. The problem, though, and that is also where your work would be extremely relevant, is that although this Committee on World Food Security should normally be able to address global food security in a holistic way, looking at development cooperation, food aid, investment, the intellectual property rights, and so on, it is de facto prohibited from looking at trade because that is the domaine réservé of the WTO, who do not want it to be discussed in Rome because they say it's in Geneva that these things are negotiated about. And it's a complex thing, and I'm aware of time myself, but it's a very interesting area, I think, in which the question of global democracy is really on the table and being experimented with, very promising. And I should also say that within the EU, in a group that Susan very graciously mentioned, the International Panel of Experts on Sustainable Food Systems, we are now developing a campaign for EU common food policy, not an agricultural policy, a common food policy, because we feel that the decisions as they are made at EU level are not democratic and transparent enough, and that if they were more accountable to the population, they would be different. They would be different. We cannot dissociate demands for democratic reform from the substance of the claims made in the name of the right to food. Secondly, you're absolutely right about the South, and in fact, the most remarkable developments concerning the right to food come from Brazil, Guatemala, places where they've been right to food laws adopted and councils in which civil society is represented have been established, and India, where they have the Brown versus Board of Education case in the right to food is in India. It's a right to food case that was launched in 2001 by the Public Union for Civil Liberties, an NGO in India, that has led the Indian Supreme Court to adopt dozens of orders addressed to the 28 states of the Indian Federation, universalizing social rights that can protect people from hunger and malnutrition. I'm a great admirer of this. I work a lot with the Right to Food campaign in India, and I think it's a stellar example of what the right to food can achieve, although based, in that case, on the right to life of Article 21 of the Indian Constitution. Jamie Oliver, absolutely, we cooperated exactly in the spirit that you indicate. And finally, on competition policy, I was disappointed at the response given by policymakers to the brief I prepared on this. And that is because, and as you know, the inquiry launched in the US by the Department of Justice and the US and the Department of Agriculture in 2010 on concentration in the meat sector, the meat packing sector, was also met an impasse, right? Nothing came out of it, despite Eric Holder in particular having invested lots of energy into this. And the reason in Europe and in the US, the reason why competition law has failed is because the focus of policymakers remains on consumer welfare. And as you perfectly well know, and consumer welfare is understood as low prices of food and a variety of foods during all seasons, right? All year round. They are not interested in using competition law to address the abuse of buyer power, cheating suppliers of agricultural products or raw materials, and especially not if these food producers are in the global south, and by being exploited can provide the affluent population in the west with, you know, cheap coffee and bananas. I think the focus of these competition policies remain on maximizing the welfare of the consumer in the short run, and never mind for the poor farmers in developing countries being cheated by these imbalances in food chains. That's my short, non-technical, much more political conclusion. There's one exception to this, which is in South Africa, where the Competition Commission has been protecting dairy farmers from an abusive practice of the buyers. But it's interesting to note that the competition law in South Africa, because it was the result of the post-apartheid reconstruction of South Africa, is explicit about black empowerment, is explicit about supporting small farmers, and so competition policy there serves other aims than those that our competition policies in the north are meant to serve. But I've grown pessimistic about the possibility for competition policy to provide solace to us if we are concerned about power relationships in food systems, and delighted that people like you continue to insist on this.
Well, thank you. This has been, I think you'll agree, an extraordinarily illuminating and inspiring presentation, and not only because you highlight experiments and innovations that are leading us towards a sustainable food system, but also because you don't underestimate the obstacles that lie in the way of that. You highlight also the difficulties, the resilience of this productivist paradigm we've been stuck with for so many decades. Well, thank you all very much for coming out this evening, and thank you for those wonderful interventions and questions. And most of all, please join me in thanking Professor De Schutter for this wonderful talk.
Thank you.